House Bill 1230 basically moves the money away from the general fund, the general fund largely used for health care and education and the support of state government, moves money away from the general fund to a large project development fund that the governor can use at his discretion to give, you know, basically corporate subsidies to large, very large projects.
We're certainly looking at a number of different mechanisms to reduce some of the burden of the cuts on K-12 and on Medicaid.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Statehouse program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
A bill concerning discrimination in the workplace, and the governor, as well as party leaders, all give their weekly press briefings. These were just a few of the happenings going on at the Capitol today, the 24th day of the 2011 legislative session. Hello and welcome to State House. I'm Stephanie Rissler. We'll start things off with testimony from the Senate Commerce and Energy Committee. Lawmakers there looked at a measure that will beef up the current workplace discrimination law. Senator Angie Buell from Sioux Falls brought the bill to the committee.
The bill itself adds these two new categories, which are already both covered in federal law as far as employment and housing are concerned. Although they're already covered, I think it does make sense for us to include them here, especially when our existing statutes already other enumerate other federally protected categories like race, sex, religion, and disability. Let me speak first about the veterans category. The federal patchwork that exists regarding veterans is not always entirely clear and may not be always adequate for everyone. There's a couple of areas that I'll talk about. First is the Vietnam Area Veterans Readjustment Assistance Act, which applies to those Vietnam Area veterans, but that only applies to federal contractors with $100,000 in contracts or more. So that obviously leaves a fair amount of South Dakota employers that wouldn't fall under that. The more broad-reaching one is USERRA, which I'm sure Senator Johnston is fairly familiar. And that applies to all employers regardless of size, but there are a number of criteria that employees have to meet to be covered, and I'm concerned that it could be a bit confusing if they don't see this particular enumerated category in the existing statute. Other states do have military and veteran status in their non-discrimination statutes, including Illinois, Mississippi, New York, Washington State, and Wisconsin. Now, I understand that you'll hear from opponents on this that this could create problems as far as veterans preference hiring programs, and I don't believe that any of those states have had issues with that or issues with duplicating federal law as well. I know there's at least one veterans group testifying in support of this after me, so I'll let them talk about specific experiences veterans have concerning these areas. Now I can move on to the age section of the bill. Age is also already covered in federal law, but that, to my understanding, does not cover all ages. It only applies to folks 40 and above and exempts employers with fewer than 20 employees. 48 other states have recognized this as a problem, and many of them opted to include age as a standalone in their non-discrimination statutes. The one other state that South Dakota is currently in company with is Arkansas. Ultimately, I don't think it's our intent to discriminate against people based on age or their veteran status, so I do think it makes sense for us to spell that out in the section and statute where we spell everything else out that we intend, so I think it makes that a little bit more clean and clear.
While the department understands the intent of SB 161, we're going to oppose the bill because we feel it is too broad and unnecessary. One problem with the bill is that it prohibits age discrimination. And as you've heard this morning, that it doesn't classify what the age is. This is a similar problem that the 2010 legislator had with a bill last year, which it rejected. Without identifying an actual age group, a blanket age discrimination would create such a broad class that it would open up every employer in the state of South Dakota to age discrimination lawsuit from anyone they interview and refuse to hire or someone that they fire. As you've heard this morning, currently federal law prohibits covered employers from discriminating against individuals who are 40 and over. However, the federal government limited it to employers who have 20 or more employees because smaller employers should not have to bear the legal costs that come with such a discrimination lawsuit. A mom-and-pop store in small-town South Dakota with 6 employees should not have to worry about being sued based upon age discrimination because it chose to hire a 27-year-old for a job rather than a 17-year-old for a job. Not only is the language of SB 161 too broad, but it is unnecessary because it covers issues that are currently handled by federal law. Not only does federal law cover age discrimination in regards to employment, but it also covers age discrimination in educational programs and any federally funded financial housing programs. Additionally, federal laws have covered, prohibits discrimination against veterans for employment and home financing and mortgaging. The need to protect our veterans, the department understands, it's a very worthy cause, and we understand it. And this is why the federal government has taken the lead on this issue and have passed the laws that it has to protect our veterans from discrimination. With regards to discrimination against age and veterans, with the other classes that this bill speaks about, the education institution, the public accommodations, advertising, currently there's no law prohibiting such discrimination. However, the department is unaware that we have a problem in South Dakota in these areas. It has never been brought to our attention. Currently, the federal laws are working in regards to age discrimination and military status discrimination in South Dakota. And for this reason, we believe SB 161 is unnecessary. And I'd like to thank you for your time this morning. And I would ask for your support in opposition to 161.
I was involved in the original first public discrimination law in 1961. I was at that time finance chairman for the Republican Party and visited with the leadership, and I knew very little about the legislative process, but I visited with the leadership, and exactly the same thing was said to me then. Well, you know, we don't discriminate in South Dakota, and, you know, what bothers you, Stan? Why are you doing this? And I remember sharing this with Governor Archie Grubert at that time, and he helped me get this done. Allegations often you don't hear about. What infuriated me at the time and made me really work at it was that a black major who had won the Distinguished Flying Cross in Korea and had reservations for himself and his family in a motel in South Dakota, coming across his state, is one look at his face, and he was refused his room, and he had to explain that to his children and drive the rest of the way across, and we didn't have a completed interstate. So allegations or not, those that have worn the uniform are often ignored by those who haven't.
I still latch on to my days as the executive director of the Employer Support of the Garden Reserve, and we have a little bit about ESGR is we have a statewide network of members, business leaders, literally in every, you know, corner of the state, who serve as liaisons between their communities, the soldiers, airmen, Army, Air, Navy, regardless of service, and in many cases active duty, to address the issues that this bill addresses. Included in the community liaisons, we have ombudsmen throughout the state who are generally lawyers who work on and with on the provisions of the Uniformed Services Employment and Reemployment Rights Act on behalf of soldiers, airmen, folks who wear the uniform, to address the things that this bill addresses. And so I feel this piece of legislation is duplicative. There's already federal laws on the books to do to address the things that this bill is intending to do. And we have a ongoing system in place in our great state to address it. And in my almost 4 years of being the executive director of the Employer Support of the Garden Reserve, I never had one case of discrimination.
After amending the bill to remove the references to age, the Senate Commerce and Energy Committee voted to send it on as amended with a 7-0 vote. It will now go down to the floor. It's now time for our legislator's spotlight piece. It allows us to highlight a few state lawmakers each night. Take a look at who's up tonight. This morning, members of the Republican Party sat down with the media for their weekly press briefings and spoke about economic development and funding for education.
As we're nearing, we've reached the halfway point, nearing crossover day, which means we have to get all the bills out of the respective houses over to the other side. We're looking to address the budget concerns by looking at everything. And I mean, everything's on the table. The way we're doing that are through three work groups. We have a work group that's specifically focused on Medicaid, or what we call health care provider dollars, education, and revenues, or revenue enhancers. Those three subgroups have been meeting now for a week diligently. They will, I suspect, in the next several days, open up those meetings and bring in some other folks from outside for kind of expert testimony. For example, the Medicaid folks will bring in the provider groups and say, what do you see are the hurdles? How can we help you get through this, et cetera? So, another thing we've been looking at, and I mean, again, the all options are on the table. We really are focusing on looking at the plans and trying to find either the pluses or the negatives to those plans. And for example, spreading the several folks have spoken about spreading the cuts out over 2 years, 3 years, et cetera. And so we broke that down actually in a 2-year plan, which looked at cutting 5% both years. What we found was that if you put the problem out another year, it actually adds to the deficit. I'm not a banker, but simple math would tell you that you're going to have some interest on that deficit. So if we cut it by 5% this year, it would be $63.5 million. And so if you put that out till next year, because of interest on that deficit, it actually increases the deficit to almost $65 million that we would have to, or a 5.2% cut we'd have to look at next year instead of 5%. And the only way to get the deficit down this year would be to take the reserves out. And if we do that this year, next year we'd only have $43 million left in reserves, still facing that almost $5 million deficit. So, again, it's a plan. We're looking at all of them. And not that that is or isn't off the table, but we're just trying to show all the aspects of what would happen if we do some different plans. So,
one of the committees that I'm on is education, and as a former educator, that fits me well. Some of the bills that we've been looking at this past week have included the technical institutes to be able to increase their level of bonding. And they have seen a large increase in the number of students that are attending those institutes. And when we increase the bonding level from $80 million to $105, that is no negative effect on our budget, our general fund budget. That's just the authority that they can increase that. So they can improve some of the building facilities that they have and to help meet the needs of the increase in the number of students that they have. Another bill that has been moving through is looking at mandates that school districts are facing and looking for ways that might be a possibility for them to not have to spend as many dollars if some of those mandates and hurdles that they have can be taken away. Another one that, and we have more than one bill that address the capital outlay fund for our school districts. And those are ways that the legislature is looking at possibly to give more flexibility for the school districts in the use of those funds. And even though we don't have the dollars, we can look at ways that we can use dollars that are already there.
On the House side, we're certainly looking at a number of different mechanisms to reduce some of the burden of the cuts on K-12 and on Medicaid. We've got a number of various work groups that are working daily on both of those issues. And I think we've identified some solutions to both of those issues. Representative Sly and Senator Rave have touched a little bit on the Cutler-Gabriel bills that are out there to reduce some of the impact of the cuts on K-12, also some of the capital outlay options to provide some local flexibility, and we're also dealing with a number of different scenarios as it relates to Medicaid providers and sort of going through the process of evaluating each of those providers differently and looking at different ways to see those cuts do as little harm as possible to the citizens who need them most and to the citizens of South Dakota.
Next, the Democratic leadership spoke about their concerns regarding funding for education and the evaluation of ag land.
I think there's been probably the topic of the week is economic development. You've probably heard from our Republican colleagues a little earlier, and I think there's a lot of misinformation, a lot of accusations and inaccuracies spreading around about some of the economic development bills that are floating around this Capitol, especially House Bill 1230, which we're going to vote on later today on the House side, and if it survives in the House, we'll be moving over to the Senate, so it'll continue to be an issue. But I just think we need some leadership in economic development here in the legislature and here in Pierre. What we don't need is all this power lobbying that's going on just for the sport of, I think, winning a bill, a bad bill, in my opinion. We can all agree, I think, that the best way to solve our problems in South Dakota, whether you're talking about the budget management problem here in Pierre, or whether you're talking about how to fund education on into the future, whether you're talking about how to take care of our sick and elderly through Medicaid, all those problems could be solved or greatly alleviated if we could just create more prosperity, more wealth through economic development. That's something we can agree on. And I think we've had really broad bipartisan support this session already on some things that really could be quite controversial. But it's because we agree on those principles that I think we've had some good support. Democrats have agreed on a administration proposal to try to add some real incentives for the aviation industry. We've just agreed today in House taxation on a bill to greatly expand TIFs, something that could be quite controversial. We took away the blighted language and said that you can create a TIF for any reason, for any economic development reason, something that normally probably wouldn't pass on a bipartisan vote. We support the governor on the sale of public lands around South Dakota and moving that money toward the Ready Fund. We support the governor on reforming some of the ethanol subsidies, again, I think moving those dollars to the Ready Fund. But there's one bill, House Bill 1230, that you just heard about. That is bad legislation, and it needs to be killed, and I hope we'll get some Republican support today or somewhere in the Senate to do that. House Bill 1230 basically moves the money away from the general fund, the general fund largely used for health care and education and the support of state government, moves money away from the general fund to a large project development fund that the governor can use at his discretion to give basically corporate subsidies to large, very large projects. Now, he says he needs it to create economic development for these very large projects. We say the best economic development is education. I think study after study after study proves that to be the case.
I think Representative Hunoff, really has the credibility that we should all agree with, being a small business owner himself and witnessing what it's like in our rural communities as far as true economic development. You know, he has the buy-in, and I think we need to understand that when he's talking about economic development. And I certainly applaud their efforts in the House to work to try to find more creative ways to properly fund House Bill 1230 instead of using general fund dollars. A few things that I would like to address, but first off, if you look at the rank and file people out there in South Dakota, the date that they are gearing towards is March 2nd. March 2nd is Speak Up for Kids Day, and there will be floods of real people throughout South Dakota who will be here in the Capitol. Watch out, and I can't wait. It reminds me very fondly of the smoking ban. You know, that's how the smoking ban was achieved. You know, I remember arriving to the floor that day, and it was covered with white coats. There were many doctors and nurses who were in the Capitol. You know, we couldn't even hardly get to our desk because so many people were there, and the smoking ban was a real issue for them. Again, the cuts to education and Medicaid are real issues, and folks across South Dakota are forming petition drives. You know, they're speaking very loudly. They are not happy with these cuts, and they're not going to give up. And then whenever I get a chance to visit with them, whether it's Cracker Barrels, whether it's, you know, visiting and conversations on the phone, I tell them, don't give up until we actually adjourn sine die. That's when things are actually final, and we will head back to our home communities, and that's where we'll have to live with the results of this legislative session. Something that has been very interesting for me to be at the vantage point has been to continue to work on the implementation of the agriculture land for productivity method when we value that based for taxation. That legislation has been coming through the Senate, more specifically in our Senate Ag Committee, but also on the Senate floor. And if you look at this legislation, it really hasn't been a strictly partisan issue either way. And I've enjoyed that, and that's where it's neat that as legislators we come from our home areas and we see these issues. Well, my personal involvement for a bill like this is to really look at the young farmers throughout South Dakota. It's very hard to compete with the high-priced dollar of land, and so if we can at least find a fair way, in this case, base it on the productivity, it helps to at least keep things more equitable for our young producers.
Governor Daugaard addressed the media as well and gave his perspective on how the session is progressing and reiterated the importance of tackling the budget deficit this year.
It's a busy week in the legislature. We're now approaching the crossover date next week when all bills must be out of their house of origin and on to the next house if they are to survive. And so there's a lot of action on the floor, and the floor calendars are getting full, and the days are getting longer. I don't have any particular issue to begin with, aside from the one. I'm going to talk a little bit about the National Science Foundation's decision to release $4 million of their appropriation for the Deep Underground Science and Engineering Labs at Homestake. This was very good news. It was confirmed by the University of California, whose physicist, Dr. Kevin Lesko, is one of the co-principal investigators. This funding will carry us until the beginning of the next federal fiscal year, October 1st of this year. And as you know, the president's budget includes an appropriation of $15 million through the Department of Energy to continue funding for the lab at that point. So this is definitely very good news. We believe that state funding will carry the lab continued dewatering, continued operation through June, and then this National Science Foundation funding will take over at that point. And again, the Department of Energy is requesting funding in the federal fiscal year 12 to carry on from there. So very good news. We're very hopeful that this will continue to be a great opportunity for South Dakota. Another point I'd like to make is the National Science Board's decision earlier not to provide funding for the lab itself was accompanied by a statement that they continue to look favorably upon scientific experiments at the lab. And this is the National Science Foundation's traditional means of funding science. It's through experiments, not through facilities. So this does return, I guess, to the more traditional pattern where the Department of Energy operates national labs and the National Science Foundation's funding is for experiments. So we think this is good news for the state, and we're very pleased about it. On one other point on this matter, I'll be going to the National Governors Association meeting next week. I understand that the attendance by the nation's governors will be very high. I believe if you include the territories, there's around 55 governors, including governors of territories, who are invited to this. And I believe there's 49, I think it was, confirmed attendees, something like that. Very high percentage of governors who are attending. And I have letters of request to the Department of Energy to the National Science Foundation and to the White House for meetings with their staff to confirm our understanding of the intentions for funding both the lab itself and experiments down the road. So I'm hoping to further our cause while I'm in Washington, D.C., at the National Governors Association. We had intended all along that the National Science Foundation would take over funding for the lab and have those employees become federal employees, federally funded employees. And really, they still will work as employees of the science and engineering lab or as members of a private LLC corporation. But in any case, the funding would stream from the federal government, not from the general fund. And that was the point in the FTE count. We count as part of our state budget FTEs that are funded by the state as state employees, and those that are funded by the federal government, they would come off our state count. So that would not change. And as you recall, our plan was to get a larger amount of funding from the National Science Foundation. And while we would have preferred to get $29 million or so rather than four, it doesn't change the fact that the funding is coming from the National Science Foundation and will come in time for our new state fiscal year beginning July 1.
And before we wrap things up tonight, the State House crew would like to send our congratulations to Senator Todd Schleckaway and his wife, Jill. They welcomed their first child today, Gavin James, weighing in at a very healthy 11 pounds and 22 inches long. Congratulations to the both of you. And that will wrap up this edition of State House. To see more information on any of the bills we cover, just go to our website at sdpb.org/statehouse, where everything is archived there in its entirety. Now for the entire State House team, we thank you for watching. Good night.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.